Please welcome First President Paul Gudonis.
Welcome to the 2007 First Robotics Competition Kickoff, live from Manchester, New Hampshire. There's a lot of really exciting information and a new game to show you today. FIRST is possible because of the generous sponsors and suppliers whose names you've just seen and many others. And now we are honored that Governor John Lynch of New Hampshire has joined us to help us kick off these proceedings. Governor?
Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you very much. Good morning. I am so happy to be here for the kickoff of the first robotics competition. First of all, I want to thank Dean Kamen and FIRST and welcome Governor Lingle, who came all the way from Hawaii to attend this local kickoff event in New Hampshire, which is the birthplace of FIRST competition. I can tell you that we are very, very proud of Dean Kamen and very proud of the fact that FIRST was started here in New Hampshire and continues to thrive here in the Granite State. I also want to thank you all so much for participating. And we need to also recognize the teachers, the parents, your mentors, and so many of the other volunteers who will be supporting your efforts in the weeks and the months ahead. Now, I know you're very anxious for the unveiling of the game, so I'll be very brief. It's important to note that while this competition is about science and math and technology and engineering, it's also about innovation. It's about learning to dream how to make this world a better place and daring to invent that dream and make that dream come true. There has never been a more important time, I think, in our history as to the importance of developing skills in science and math, engineering and technology. The challenges of the future demand these skills. Here in New Hampshire, we understand that our future depends on people like you. It will be the inventors, the engineers, the scientists, and the others just like you that lead the way in innovation. You should all know that as governor of the state of New Hampshire, I am personally committed to FIRST, and I will do everything that I can to get all of the other governors to rally around and to recognize the importance of FIRST for our country. Best of luck to all of you. Have fun, do your best, and may you reach your goal of making it to the championships in Atlanta. Thank you very much.
Please welcome FIRST Chairman John Abele.
Welcome. Well, we have 46 local kickoff remote sites this morning, all the way from Alaska to Israel to Brazil and everything in between. So good morning to all of you, the 260 rookie teams, 1,043 veteran teams who are participating in this year's FIRST Robotics session. And thanks again to all of our sponsors and suppliers, without whom none of this would be possible. Especially thanks to FIRST sponsors, NASA, who are making this broadcast and webcast possible. And we are also delighted to welcome Brooks Automation, a new sponsor of the 2007 kickoff, along with NASA. Brooks Automation invests in youth to help support their interest and unlimited potential in technology and engineering and manufacturing. This year, FIRST participation has added 4 new regionals, bringing the total number to 37, and of course the championship in Atlanta. As you can see, there's a growing interest outside the U.S., as well as including 67 teams in Canada, 34 in Israel, 15 in Brazil, 5 in the United Kingdom, and 1 in Mexico, and 1 in the Netherlands. Welcome to all of you. Thank you also to the team leaders, the volunteers, and the board members for attending the events all around the country and the various sites. The FIRST Robotics competition is not about machines. It's about people. It's about learning to work together with others towards a shared goal. It's about teamwork. It's about collaboration, innovation, resourcefulness, a sense of urgency, and, of course, gracious professionalism. In keeping with those values, FIRST's highest award is not about machines. It's not about people. It's about groups of people. The ultimate FIRST prize is the Chairman's Award. It goes to that team which exemplifies partnership. In fact, teams that have won the Chairman's Award are our role models for all of you for transforming the culture into one that honors science and technology. To celebrate the success of our Chairman's Award teams, 15 teams have earned the right to be induced into the FIRST Hall of Fame. The Hall of Fame teams remain active in our cause and serve as examples for the rest of us to follow. The team that wins the Chairman's Award is now also given a rare opportunity to work with Hollywood producer Paul Lazarus on a video about the team. Each year, the Chairman's Award winning team is given a broadcast quality video camera, for a few months to capture some of the team's activities, and then Paul and his team edit the footage to make a wonderful record of their accomplishment. This past season, Team 111, Wild Stang, from Schaumburg, Illinois, won. We look forward to seeing their video at this year's championship in Atlanta. The winner in 2005 was Team 67, General Motors Milford Proving Ground and Huron Valley Schools. Here is their story.
The Chairman's Award 2005.
Let's celebrate the heroes of tomorrow. Team 67, the hot team, General Motors and Huron Valley Schools.
What makes a hero? Fancy tights? Hitting it out of the park? Defeating the forces of evil? Ask Dean Kamen.
Heroes are people that do extraordinary things, hopefully to make the world a better place for the people around them. At FIRST, our heroes are the Chairman's Award winners.
Who's hot? We're hot!
67 puts the pedal to the metal when it comes to building a team. With its dedicated parents, teachers, engineers, and longtime sponsor, General Motors.
Getting to work at GM has been a really interesting thing. Not a lot of people in our community are able to get into the proving grounds, and it's really amazing that we have been able to.
I got into the program because as director of our proving ground, I couldn't hire engineers and technicians. They just weren't there. And now General Motors runs 42 teams, and you can really get outstanding engineers that we're so desperately short of.
Who's hot? We're hot!
Team 67 has a very dynamic relationship with our community. So we've been involved with local businesses, road cleanups, river cleanups. We're really out there in terms of being in the community and being visible.
Like wildfire, the heroes of tomorrow spread the word.
Casey is our community service robot. We want to take it to like hospitals, and we didn't want it to be scary for little kids. We actually just learned how to make balloon animals so that we could give them to little kids and everything. It was really great.
I proudly display a little Lego Judges Award. On top of that Judges Award is the Hot Team cap. And believe me, it has spurred a lot of imagination among state senators.
Go FIRST!
Heroes of sportsmanship, gracious professionalism, team spirit. Hot 67 is all about helping others.
At regionals, we give out peer awards to encourage team spirit and great engineering.
Team 406, Mumford, they lost their sponsorship and needed some help getting started.
We went to them and they just came to us with open arms and they accepted us in and they let us come to where they were building their own robot.
And they helped build our robot in 9 days.
Who's hot? You're hot!
Heroes of tomorrow share what they know.
It's great to pass on what you learned from robotics to younger students. Every year we help set up and volunteer for the Michigan State LEGO League competition.
First has truly contributed to encouraging women to go into engineering because a lot of the young women who see it see other women who are engineers helping out. It lets them know that if they can do it, I can do it.
Who's hot? We're hot!
I've seen kids that have come back to me in later years and said, if it weren't for being on this team, I'd be selling burgers and flipping fries right now. Instead, I'm working on an engineering degree. That's the kind of stuff that makes a hero. And heroes aren't just on Team 67. They're on all the teams that are out there in first.
Who's hot?
We're hot!
Who's hot?
We're hot!
Please welcome back First President Paul Gudonis.
Well, what a year this has been. Since I joined First just a year ago, I have witnessed a celebration of achievement and teamwork all across this country. Each of you, students, teachers, mentors, judges, sponsors, each of you is doing a terrific job in working together to create excitement for science, technology, and innovation. During my travels, I met some incredible people. There was Team 1868, an all-girls team, the Space Cookies, inside this giant NASA hangar, calculating the parabolic trajectory of last year's ball to score points in the Aim High game. There was another all-girls team, the Green Grinches, who proudly displayed these words on their pit banner. Whoever said, "May the best man win," never asked a girl to play. In Texas, a team from Mexico City made a special trip to participate in the regional First VEX Challenge. I was in Toronto. I saw the playing field covered with costumes during the Dance of the Mascots. And at the First Championship in Atlanta, we were all greeted in 15 languages by First LEGO League teams from around the world. And who could forget that example of gracious professionalism during the final round of the FRC Championship, when one team provided a critical part to the other alliance. It's a tremendous honor to be part of this First community. Well, before you see this year's challenge, I want to give you an update on our First programs. We're having another record year with a total of 11,850 teams across all of our programs. This year, over 130,000 students are going to participate thanks to the support of 45,000 volunteers who make First happen. I'd like to make a special welcome to the rookie teams and to the veteran teams. Welcome back, and thank you for your gracious professionalism in recruiting and mentoring a record number of rookie teams this year. Our middle school program, the First LEGO League, is also growing strongly. This year, over 9,000 teams from 45 countries participated in the 2006 NanoQuest Challenge, where they explored science and created innovations at the molecular level. Here's a quick look at this year's FLL Challenge.
First, in partnership with the LEGO Group, designs annual real-world challenges for teams of children aged 9 to 14 through the First LEGO League. This year, FLL worked with nanotechnology experts to explore how this new revolutionary area of research enhances existing technologies provide solutions never thought possible. Since mid-September, more than 90,000 children in 45 countries around the globe joined the 2006 NanoQuest First LEGO League Challenge. teams researched current and potential applications of nanotechnology and then shared their findings with their communities and a panel of judges at FLL championship events. Teams discover the world of individual atoms, a world 100,000 times smaller than the thickness of a strand of hair, where buckyballs, carbon nanotubes, molecular motors, and quantum dots are considered part of ordinary conversation. Through this cutting-edge field of research, teams unlock the secrets of everyday items and delved into today's nanotechnology applications with 9 missions, including test for stain-resistant clothing and deploying smart medicine. Looking into the future, teams simplified space travel by activating a space elevator. By identifying challenges and creatively applying the nanotechnology research of today, students design solutions with one goal in mind: improving our quality of life. FLL teams, solving problems and inspiring change.
Well, again, congratulations to our first LEGO League for a tremendous season. There's also been a very exciting development for first LEGO League this year. The team that wins the World Festival Champions Award will receive an all-expenses-paid trip to IBM's Almaden Research Facility in San Jose, California. The team will spend the day touring the center and will meet with world-class scientists, including the father of nanotechnology, IBM fellow Don Eigler. The team will share their NanoQuest Challenge project presentation and demonstrate their robot's performance for the scientists. And the team will then be able to manipulate atoms at the nanotech level using low-temperature STM labs and then building their own atomic structures. We're all very excited to see which FLL team gets to go. But did you know that there are even younger prospective FRC teammates out there? Our junior first LEGO League teams. This year, over 700 teams of 6 to 9-year-olds studied scale and nanotechnology alongside our FLL teams. They had an opportunity to show off their creations at 32 junior first LEGO League expos in the US, Canada, and Mexico. Many FRC teams are mentoring the FLL and junior first LEGO League teams and even taking on the challenge of running their events and the expos. Your efforts make a tremendous difference, and I really want to thank you for that to FRC teams. Well, after a very successful pilot last year, we've expanded the first VEX challenge this year with new partners and locations around the country, and teams have started building robots that are hanging around local tournaments. Last year's challenge, the Half Pipe Hustle, involved a half a dozen tournaments across the country with the leading teams invited to the championship in Atlanta. Well, this year we've been able to bring a first program to even more schools and students. So let's take a quick look at the first VEX challenge.
The first VEX challenge. A whole new level of learning fun. 5,000 students on 500 teams. 27 events across North America and at the first championship, sharing the excitement and the rewards of science, technology, and engineering. The challenge is revealed every September during the online kickoff. Teams brainstorm a strategy and then program, build, and test their robot. The FVC 2006 challenge? Hanging around. Robots collect softballs and score points, placing them in high or low goals. Possessing a large Atlas ball doubles the points, and parking on a rotating platform or hanging from the center structure pumps up your score even higher. Teams compete for a variety of awards, including engineering, design excellence, competitive play, sportsmanship, and high-impact partnerships between schools, businesses, and communities. First VEX Challenge motivates students to learn science, math, and technology, implements classroom learning, inspires new ideas and concepts, promotes teamwork, collaboration, and mentorship through hands-on learning drives students to excel. FVC. Are you ready for the challenge?
I'd like to thank those FRC teams that have mentored First VEX Challenge teams in your areas. It's a great way to groom future FRC team members, as well as to enable more students to discover the excitement and the rewards of science and technology and engineering. Well, now I'd like to switch our focus to another group of essential volunteers, the team leaders and mentors. Because we at FIRST know how much work and time is involved in supporting any team, especially an FRC team. There is so much more to this than just building a robot. This is a complex exercise in project management, in creativity, and perseverance, and we thank all of you for taking part in changing the lives of the kids involved and indeed helping to make the next generation stronger and able to meet the challenges ahead. It just simply wouldn't happen without you. Now, I'd like to share with you a couple of brief stories from the past year. These stories are just a couple of examples from the thousands of lives that you as a FIRST mentor or a team leader touch and change every year. These are the stories of three students from the Wildstank team that was sponsored by Motorola and which had won the 2006 Chairman's Award. They graduated in June 2006 from Rolling Meadows High School in Illinois, and they all know that Dan Green, their team mentor, was an invaluable contributor to their success. Tim Sion was a four-year team member of the Wildstank team, a pit crew member. He won the Allaire Scholarship to college that is available to any student on a Chairman's Award-winning team and now attends Southern Illinois University, and he's majoring in mechanical engineering. The scholarship greatly alleviated the burden of college tuition for his mother and him. Tiffany Gratch never intended to have anything to do with FIRST, but her brother had been on the team. So freshman year, Tiffany decided to give FIRST a try. She became a four-year team member of Wildstang and became a leader of the electrical team. Now Tiffany is attending Western Michigan University, majoring in software and electrical engineering. Kelly Van Antwerp was also a four-year team member of Wildstang. She was the leader of the video team and now attends Columbia College in Chicago, majoring in documentary television and media arts. Well, over the years, nine Wildstang team members have been hired by Motorola as interns. Then they graduated from college. Then they were hired as Motorola engineers. And then most of them have become mentors for Wildstang. Well, these stories represent what happens everywhere there's a FIRST team and a committed group of teammates and mentors. So please join me in thanking all the mentors, all the FIRST teams deeply, sincerely, and often. So let's kick off the season with a standing ovation wherever you are watching this broadcast for all of our mentors and team leaders. Thank you, mentors and team leaders. Well, I've got some other exciting news about the process that you and mentors and team leaders and all of the team members are about to undertake. A book called FIRST Robots Behind the Design will be released at this year's championship in Atlanta. This first book features 30 award-winning teams and their robots from the 2006 FIRST Robotics Competition. The book uses gorgeous color images and descriptions written by teams to describe how they progressed from their initial ideas to their completed robots. The publisher of the book, Rockport, will be publishing a second book featuring robots designed this year. Like last year, teams that win an engineering award at a FIRST competition are invited to submit documentation that will be reviewed for publication. A complete description of the book publication process is included in the awards section of the 2007 FRC manual. So your chances to be included in the 2007 book are a function of your team's ability to document your work, so take lots of pictures and notes during the next 6 weeks. I've seen preview chapters of this book. It's beautiful, it's informative, and definitely first class. Now, I know folks are interested in learning which teams are profiled in the 2006 book. Well, in true first kickoff fashion, we're going to keep that under wraps until the book is published and released at the championship in April in Atlanta. Well, finally, I want to encourage you to have a lot of fun as you design and build and compete with your robots. And I also want you to be safe as you, during every step of your journey here. You're about to create big, fast-moving machines, and we at FIRST take safety very seriously. We're very grateful to Underwriters Laboratory, which is the ultimate brand name in product safety, for the safety program that they've created for FIRST, including regional safety advisors, training for our advisors and experts, and also providing safety supplies. So please learn from your safety advisors and your fellow team members. We're also grateful to Autodesk for their ongoing support with CAD software and 3D Studio Max animation software. And with the software provided, teams submitted a computer-based animation video to help us highlight one aspect of safety. This year's winner is Team 375, Robotic Plague, sponsored by Richmond County Savings Foundation, Verizon, Con Ed, and Staten Island Technical High School. So please join me in watching this video, and then I'll see you at one of the regional competitions or in Atlanta. Good luck, and have a lot of fun.
Hi, I'm Philip, the first aid kit. It can get dangerous in the workshop. That's why you should take all safety precautions. Keep your work area clean and organized. Keep a fire extinguisher nearby in case a fire breaks out. Remember to have safety goggles and gloves at hand. And always remember to have a first aid kit ready in case needed. Hi, Bill. What's up?
Nothing, just hanging out.
Teams, have a successful build season. And remember to keep yourselves surrounded by safety.
Please welcome longtime FIRST friend, FIRST Executive Advisory Board member, and Senior Vice President and Chief Engineer of New York City Transit Authority, Connie Crawford.
Good morning. Good morning. As you know, engineers are heavily involved in transportation. We design and build trains, planes, automobiles, and even segways. We also design and build the infrastructure that supports transportation, highways, bridges, airports, and if you're in the subway business, subway tunnels, railroad tracks, signal systems, communication networks, maintenance shops, and so forth. In fact, at New York City Transit, we have a capital program of over $2 billion a year to keep the trains and buses running in New York. And that takes a lot of engineers. We have over 1,600 engineers, architects, and other professionals just working to make sure the trains and buses run in New York. These folks come in, they work hard every day, but they have great fun. They're solving problems every day, just as you do in your first competitions. And they know that the work they do is vital, because without the subways and buses in New York, the city would come to a standstill. Where do we get our engineers? We get them from colleges. And FIRST makes it easier for you to go to college by aligning itself with over 70 organizations, colleges, universities, professional associations, and corporations to provide $7.5 million a year in scholarships for FIRST students. Scholarships to go to great universities all over the country, Arizona State, Boston University, Drexel, Georgia Tech, ITT, MIT, University of New Hampshire, and Worcester Polytech Institute. In fact, this year, FIRST would like to recognize Worcester Polytech because 11 years ago, WPI provided the first scholarship for FIRST students. And in fact, they continue. WPI continues with this innovative leadership. Just yesterday, they provided a live webcast of the rookie workshops to share with everyone. After you go to college, well, actually, first, you want to look on the web page if you're interested in those scholarships. You can find out about them on the first web page. After you go to college, you get to go out and work as an engineer, doing great stuff. It's fun work, it's interesting challenges, and it's vital to making this this world run. So I wish the best of luck to all of you. Have fun out there. Thank you.
Please welcome first founder, Dean Kamen.
Greetings. Greetings. So, some things never change, some things always change. What's not changed is we're out of control, and that's a great thing. You heard we have over 11,000 teams. Things are going great around here and around the world. I only have a few minutes, and instead of, as you know, I can talk, I'm going to try to keep to two very specific, simple things. As usual, the last one of which will be a homework assignment. We need more help, and it's up to all of you and the people around the world now involved with FIRST to do that. The first one, though, is to try once again to make sure we never forget what we're really doing here. FIRST is not about building robots. That's going to be hard for most of you to believe when for the next 6 weeks you don't eat and you don't sleep because of robots. But please, every speaker so far has made some allusion to it. But I want to remind all of you that FIRST got started for a simple reason. We have a culture that gets what it celebrates. We're a free culture. And even kids are free to do what they want. And we celebrate extraordinarily well the world of sports and entertainment. And I think we do it so well we sometimes forget that those things aren't the source of our wealth, they're a result of it. Our wealth, our security, our health care, the lights are on, the water's drinkable, the planes fly, your cars are affordable, safe, clean. All of that stuff happens. We take it for granted. It happens because of an incredible group of scientists and engineers that in every generation have raised the bar, the quality of life, the standard of living. But now in our media age, that concept has gotten lost. 15 years ago, we decided the sports model is so powerful for creating passion, for getting kids to celebrate and focus on something. We said, let's use that model to help give kids an opportunity to see what really is important and to make science and engineering and technology seem every bit as accessible and rewarding and real, particularly to women and minorities that our culture is pretty much convinced they don't want to do this. We cheated them. We said, let's use the sports model. But the purpose of the model and the purpose of the sport isn't about the robot. It's a way to build something much more important. Relationships between the mentors and the kids. Giving kids an opportunity to see an aspect of life, potential careers that they would never, ever, ever get to actually see when they're young enough to make decisions and to decide where to put their time and their energy and their passion. We have 45,000 engineers and scientists and technicians that volunteer time. We have a few dozen people that work full-time in FIRST. A few dozen. I mean, we have 37 cities holding regionals. That's like we have about one full-time employee per New York, Chicago, Los Angeles, Cleveland, Seattle. This whole program works because it's volunteer-driven. It's driven by the passion of the technology community that in part, for its own enlightened self-interest, needs to create the next generation of leaders and inventors and creators. In part because they're responsible professionals and citizens and parents and teachers. This whole program works because everybody cares so much to do something extra. And they do it for the kids, and I think they keep doing it because every year the kids continue to live up to our standards of gracious professionalism. The kids continue to prove that if you give somebody good advice and an opportunity, they'll seize it, and it'll make a difference. So I'm begging all of the mentors that no matter how exciting and intense the competitions are getting, like other sports, one day we will be the sport, the 21st century sport, that's part of the culture everywhere. I'm begging all of you to remember, we have a much bigger set of goals to keep at the front of our mind all the time than whether your robot wins or loses. Some of the robots will lose, some of them won't even run, but all of the participants should be winners. They will be winners if we keep track of what's really important. So my first message is just for all of you veterans, it's the booster shot. FIRST is an extraordinary group of people doing an extraordinary thing. And let's not ever lower our standards or forget why we do this. And to the students, I'll remind all of you, we don't want any of the trappings of sports that frankly are an embarrassment or inappropriate for things as important as what we're doing here and helping create the next generation of people that will determine the fate of the world. So, as usual, I have my homework. My homework has typically been over 15 years, more sponsors, more kids, more teachers, more engineers. I still want all of that. But as you all know, I'm never satisfied. Most of our board is very happy. We went from 28 teams to 11,000 teams. We went in the FIRST Robotics competition from 28 teams to 1,300. By almost any standard, including typical growth of business, that's a very, very impressive record. It's not good enough. And the reason it's not good enough is a generation of high school students is only 4 years. So it's taken us three generations plus. There's another 22,000 high schools just in the United States where kids don't have an opportunity to participate. We need to grow much faster. We're also reaching the limit of the way you can grow when you do it retail, one sponsor at a time, one new school at a time, one teacher at a time. I think if you use the model of businesses, we've had our early adopters. We've had the courageous venture capitalists that were our early board, most of whom are still with us, and our early sponsors, most of whom are still with us, the people with the courage to make this thing happen. But now I look out and say, if our original goal was change the culture of the United States so that as we continue to get what we celebrate, we're going to celebrate the right things and we're going to get more of it. It's time to really figure out how to make FIRST part of the broad culture of the country. So in addition to always looking for more sponsors, more teachers, more students, I think we need to reach outside the technical community, outside the university, engineering schools, and the technology companies, and start attracting the attention, the broad attention, of the people that do create the culture of the country, our political leaders, our cultural leaders across the country. And I think our goal ought to be to go from 1,300 FRC teams to 13,000, way faster than it got us here, because we're in a race between knowledge and catastrophe. And I think the only way we can get that far out is to reach out to the general public, to the leadership of our country. They all have the bully pulpits. And so my very specific request this year, and it's right now the beginning of the season is the time to do it, is every student, every mentor, every sponsor, you all have a senator or two. You all have a congressman. You all have a governor. We all have a president. I'm asking every one of you to write to these people, call these people, and say, we have an unbelievable program. It's been around 15 years. We've taken out the risk. We've taken out the bugs. It works. We've proved it's scalable. It has an unbelievable impact. It's incredibly cost effective. And you need it. The country needs it and the world needs it. You need to support us. And the best way, Governor Lingle said it best to me yesterday after I talked her ear off. She said, Dean, what you're telling me is you got to show them, not tell them. Because seeing all of you, seeing the kids, seeing the competition speaks for itself better than even I could. So, you're going to specifically go to all of these people, your senators, your governors. You're going to invite them to come to a regional. There's no excuse anymore why they can't do it. There's going to be 8 or 9 or 10 regionals every weekend in March. You're going to invite these people to the championship in Atlanta, April 13th, 14th. You're going to send us a copy of your invitation. That's how I'll know you did your job. And it's going to be a gracious introduction that you're going to make to them, and a gracious invitation. And we're going to publish the best ones on our website. And you're going to send us all of their answers. And we're going to publish those too. Do they get it? Do they care? Are they coming? And if they don't answer, I'm going to publish that also. That's going to be really entertaining. They're your officials. They're our leaders. They should be representing us and what's important. We can't blame them for not supporting us if they don't know we're here. We've been extraordinarily good until now, creating the program, building our credibility, and talking within the technical community and the technical colleges. It's now time to be bigger. We're ready for prime time. We ought to get them there, and then I think we don't want to be in 36 regional cities. We want to be in every city. We want to be in every school because every kid deserves an opportunity to make intelligent choices about careers. Everybody does. We ought to do that. So please do that homework. And to prove to you, by the way, that I don't ask you to do anything I don't do, I got a call from a governor. Not my own governor, who you just heard from, who's a committed governor. I got a call from a governor that's a little further away, from Hawaii, a few weeks ago. And she, like all the people that helped get First started, that early group of venture people that are willing to take risks on something new, she's one of the small group that gets it. She can help spread the word. I had my conversation with her. I hope I was gracious in my invitation to her. I said, we need you. You need us. Why don't you just jump in a plane, travel for 15 hours, leave Hawaii, come to New Hampshire, see for yourself what FIRST is all about, and help us get all the governors to get involved, to support us. And so she came. And I am very proud to introduce you to somebody who really gets it, Governor Lingle from Hawaii. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, students. Thank you. Thank you very much, Dean. Good morning and aloha. Dean, your invitation was very gracious. Everyone connected with FIRST practices gracious professionalism. I wanted to split my remarks into two parts today. First, to talk to the mentors and sponsors and let you know that you're doing so much more than just helping a group of students, although you're clearly doing that. You're helping the world to be a better place by helping these future leaders, by committing yourself and your time. When you're there and you're working week after week on your project, when you're at your regional, when you're in the pit at the championships, I know you may be thinking about the competition and the robots at that time, but what you're really doing is helping the world to be a better place. And as a mentor, you're a key to this entire organization and to the future of our world. because as you saw in the earlier video, the hot video, these are the heroes of tomorrow. But I think more importantly, students, you're the hope of tomorrow. You're the hope that will cure the diseases that have confounded scientists for decades. You're the hope that we'll be able to produce clean drinking water so that young people in countries all over the world have a chance to grow up the way you grow up, healthy and strong. You truly are the hope of tomorrow. Students, I want to thank you for participating in FIRST, and I want to ask you to make certain that when your days in FIRST are over as a competitor, you never forget what this organization did for you, that you come back as a mentor or as a sponsor when you're leading a big company, which I know many of you will be, because truly you will be this country's future leaders. And students, when I look at you, when I have a chance to talk with you as I have over the past couple of days, you make me optimistic about the future. I know the future is bright when we have leaders such as yourself stepping forward to do something important, something special, and in this case, something fun all at the same time. So have a great season at FIRST. Thanks for letting me be a part of it. Mahalo.
Please welcome Dave Lavery, NASA Program Executive for Solar System Exploration.
Thank you. Just a couple of comments very quickly, and then we'll talk about a little bit of hardware. There's been several mentions already this morning about the role of the mentors and some comments directed at the mentors. I would like to make a comment to the students with that regard. A little while ago, the FIRST board asked me to take a look to find out what sort of programs were out there that were doing things similar, at least at the topmost level, to what FIRST was trying to accomplish, or at least sounded that way. And I went out and I did a survey and found out there are 82 programs that are available to high school and undergraduate college students in this country that are robotics competition related in one fashion or another. 81 of them are fundamentally the same thing. Take a kid apart, take a problem, take a bunch of students, send them off in the corner, give them a certain time period, have them come back, show you what they did. There's one out of 82 that's different, FRC. That one that says, take a kid apart, take a bunch of students, take a period of time, send them off in the corner, but send them off in the corner with a bunch of mentors, experienced professionals, engineers, scientists, and technologists who have a professional background at problem solving, at disassembling issues, and understanding how to think through the process. And let them work together as a team. And let the students have an experience of understanding how a professional operates, how a professional thinks, how a professional problem solves as part of the process of the robotics competition. That one factor is huge and sets this entire program apart. And my comment is really directed to the students. Take advantage of the opportunity that you're being given. You're not going to find it anywhere else. You can go a lot of other places and build robots. You can't go anywhere else and have an opportunity to sit side by side with an experienced mentor and learn from them the process of professional quality engineering, science, and technology, but more importantly than that, how they think. That's what we want you to experience. That's what we want you to take away from this program. And how you're going to do that, the numbers actually rack up sort of in a fun way. Over the course of the next 6 weeks, you're going to spend an estimated 4.2 million brain hours taking apart the problem that we're about to give you. 4.2 million brain hours having fun, being passionate, thinking about what you want to do, having a great experience, focusing on something important. 4.2 million hours of brain power, changing the culture of the United States, changing the culture of the world. 4.2 million hours of brain power, doing something that has meaning. 4.2 million hours of brain power, and not a single one will be wasted on an irrelevant question like, what in the hell is Paris Hilton doing right now? So what are you going to spend those 4.2 million hours doing? It's coming. I'm going to talk about three things very quickly. First off, two things that you're not going to get in the kit, but are available to you this year if you need them. First off, we heard a lot of complaints and comments and requests over the past years from two particular groups. One is the Macintosh users that are out there. Mac users, as of this year, you can download things like the Parallels software, which will allow you to run XP and therefore allow you to run all the MP Lab, all the EZC software, not just the development tools that we're going to give you, but all the microchip development software runs on Mac under the Intel processors now. You're fully compatible with what we're doing. We've tested it. It runs. It loads on with the IFI loader onto the RC, so you're in the game now, too. Second thing I want to mention is a little piece of hardware. Again, this is not in the kit. However, it's available to the teams that want to make use of it. One of the things that you've requested for a long time is the ability to use USB-based controllers to interface with the RC hardware and the operator interface. We've listened to you. Mike Capioli and the folks at Cross the Road Technologies have worked with Innovation First and with FIRST to develop the USB chiclet. This nice little device plugs straight into the operator interface on one side and provides a serial port. And on the other side, there's a USB connection that allows you to take something like a Game Boy controller, plug it in there, and use a Game Boy controller or any other USB-based control device to control your robot. So you're no longer limited to just the flight sticks that you used to get in the kits. If you want to use something different, you can. Again, it's an option. It's not included in the kit, but we've written the rules so that these are legal devices that can be included. In fact, this is now the only device that, other than the operator interface itself, is allowed to be powered at the operator's console at the player station. So these are available through the Innovation First web store as well, and you can make use of those. The third thing I want to mention, I'm going to start walking over here, is, as you might be able to tell, the camera system is back. We're fully up and running. And one of the things the camera system is going to be able to do this year, using the software that's downloadable directly from the first website links that are up and posted, is straight out of the box with the software that can be downloaded, the camera system is designed and set up so that it will identify and track a green target light. And if you look over my shoulder here, you can see that the display is being updated in real time as I track from one side to the other. It's scanning and keeping the target in range. You can see the little red laser dot right here where it's actually targeting and pointing at the moment. And it provides pan and tilt information that gives me distance and heading information in real time that you can use to track your location relative to the current light. You may also notice it says number of targets. It can track more than one target. I have no idea why you would want to have that capability. But the other thing that it can do with that information in real time, if you have pan information and tilt information, then with very simple geometry, application of the law of sines, which everyone learned in ninth grade, I can figure out, knowing heights of a target and height of the camera, my distance to the camera and relative orientation in the robot frame of reference to where the target may be. Again, to multiple targets. Don't know why. But that's just a couple of things that you're going to find. That basic capability is again compatible with both MP Lab and with EZC. The EZC version is going to be available through the IntelliTech website. Kevin Watson's software from last year that he developed to track targets is also up and running, available, and is compatible with this problem as well. You can take those, you can extend it, you can do whatever you want to it, or just use it right out of the box, and the capability is there for you to use. What I'd like to do now is just go ahead and move on and introduce the first. Congressional representative who's been able to convince his entire state to have the FIRST robotics program installed into every high school within the state. Please welcome Congressman Jim Langeman from Rhode Island.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, good morning, everyone. Are you excited about FIRST 2007?
All right.
Well, I am too, and I'm thrilled to be here today with Dean Kamen and Governor Lingle from Hawaii, and most especially with all of you, the mentors, the staff, the volunteers, but most especially the students of FIRST. You are what this is all about. FIRST encourages our young people to go into the field of math, science, and engineering.
It's an exciting program that helps you to explore your gifts, your talents, and your dreams. I believe that each and every one of the students that are involved in this program, and really in all throughout the world, are limited only by the bounds of their own imagination. We want to encourage you to explore that imagination, particularly as it relates to math, science, and engineering. As Governor Lingle and others have stated, that much of the world's problems today can be solved through exploring math and science and engineering, some of our most challenging problems. So we're relying on you, the next generation, this generation and the next, to improve the world around us. We all have that obligation to do that. We need more support for these fields. And that's what really FIRST is all about. It's growing interest in math and science and engineering. I'm hoping and expecting that Rhode Island is going to be the first state in the country to have a FIRST program in every state, in every school in our state. And I know Hawaii is actually doing the same thing. So there's a little competition right now between Rhode Island and Hawaii, but that's okay. Competition's a great thing, right? Now it's our obligation to try to get all the states in between Rhode Island and Hawaii, who are on opposite ends of the country, to be involved in this program as well and further support math, science, and engineering. So I'm going to conclude my remarks today with a challenge. I want to echo what Dean asked you to do just a little while ago. And that's to let your members of Congress, your senators, your representatives, know about your interest and your support for FIRST and math, science, and engineering, and how important it is to our country. So here's your homework assignment. By the end of next week, each and every student, each and every mentor, whether you're a parent, a volunteer, a supporter of FIRST, you need to find out who your member of Congress is, your congressman and your senator. And by the end of the following week, you need to have either a phone call, an email, or a letter into that senator and representative, letting them know about this program and inviting them to the regional and inviting them to the national. That's your assignment. That's your challenge. I'm going to do my part in working to educate my colleagues in the United States Congress about FIRST and your interest and your involvement in supporting math, science, and engineering. But they're going to listen more to you than they are to me because you're their constituents. They represent you. So we're relying on you to get the word out. Are you ready to do your homework? Are you ready to do that? Very good. Well, if we see all the members of the United States Congress, at the regionals or the nationals, we're going to know that you did your job and that they did theirs. This is a partnership, and we're counting on you to follow through. Have a great year. I look forward to seeing you at the regionals and the nationals. This is going to be a great year for FIRST 2007. Thank you very much.
Please welcome FIRST National Advisor, Woody Flowers.
Good morning. Good morning, all. We're getting close, but please, in particular, the rookies, to whom I will speak more directly, please hang with me for a minute. So if I could make you an offer that says you can either have a great experience with the 2007 FIRST Robotics Competition, or you could be rich and famous, which do you think you'd take? Well, I think I know the answer, but there was a survey, youth around the world, and by a huge margin, being rich and famous was regarded as more important. Actually, that's the wrong answer. There's been a whole bunch of studies that make it very clear that neither money nor fame makes you happy. So, can I make an argument that FRC 2007 will make you happy? In fact, there's a very good chance that it will. How is that? Well, you're smart enough to know that you should be intimidated by what you face. You're looking at a really big, really hard problem. It's multidisciplinary. people, robots, schedules, team dynamics. If you do all that well, you will learn a very important thing. You will learn that you deserve high self-esteem. In fact, you'll learn that you deserve the right kind of self-esteem. The sociologists right now are having a discussion about a kind of self-esteem that results in arrogance and false pride and is founded mostly in insecurity. The real stuff, the stuff that I think is really important, is what people like Nathaniel Brandon identify. Please listen carefully to his definition of self-esteem. Self-esteem is the disposition to experience oneself as being competent to cope with the basic challenges of life and being worthy of happiness. It is confidence in the efficacy of our mind, in our ability to think. By extension, it is confidence in our ability to learn, make appropriate choices and decisions, and respond effectively to change. It is also the experience that success, achievement, fulfillment, and happiness are right and natural for us. The survival value of such confidence is obvious. So is the danger when it is missing. Self-esteem is not the euphoria or buoyancy that comes that may be temporarily induced by a drug, a compliment, or a love affair. It is not an illusion or hallucination. If it is not grounded in reality, if it is not built over time by the appropriate operation of mind, it is not self-esteem. That's exactly what FIRST is about. You're going to set out to build a robot, but some magic is going to happen along the way. You set a stretch goal. You're going to build a fancy, powerful, autonomous, teleoperated robot from nothing, from scratch, in 6 weeks. And along the way, you're going to learn stuff that you never thought you were going to learn. You're going to work with mentors who are giving a huge amount of their time and who know a lot about the process. You're going to do cutting-edge technology. Some of you are going to program robots to interpret vision systems. Some of you are going to make precise parts with elegant machine tools. Some of you are going to make precise enough parts with a hammer, a hacksaw, and a file. You're going to learn to manage teams' work. I hope all of you will learn to appreciate others' unique skills. You're going to do marketing plans. You're going to raise money. The list goes on. But many of you, the ones of you who put your heart into what you're doing, will change your self-image. You will come to believe that you can do stuff, that you can do hard stuff. You can do stuff that involves nature, like machines and electronics, and people. And believe me, that is a really big deal. Now, you cannot know that you can do stuff without experience. Your brain is too smart. It simply will assume that if you haven't done it, you're going to remain not a doer. I believe that FIRST is one of the cheapest opportunities you will ever have to learn that you're competent in a fast game. Now let's go over that linkage. If you know you can do, people will ask you to do more. You in turn will learn more so you can do more. That is a win-win. Society gets things done and you get the satisfaction, the deep satisfaction of knowing that you're in the game. Being in the game, folks, will make your heart sing a lot more than money or fame. Now, I'm not arguing that obscurity or poverty is the right thing, but I am saying that being in the game so you can have a meaningful life is much better than being rich and famous. Now, there's some good news. A lot of people that are rich and famous happen to be that way because they're competent and trustworthy. And if they're happy, it's most likely because of what they're able to contribute, not because of what they have. You are launching into a hard, fun project that I think is the right mix. It's high tech. All the world's problems need technology for their solution. You'll be deeply immersed in Mother Nature. She applies all of her rules all the time. She will be the unflinching arbiter of whether what you do works. You'll also be immersed in a social environment. And believe me, if you learn to work better with people, that will serve you for the rest of your life. You will do all that in the context of gracious professionalism for the next 6 weeks or the rest of your life if you behave in a way that would make your grandmother happy if she were watching all the time. You will be doing very well, and you will have more self-esteem. And that is much better than being rich and famous. So, from all that advice about the goals of FIRST, let's get down to some of the details. In particular, for a look at an important aspect of this year's game, let's hear from our head referee, Dr. Aidan Brown.
In an attempt to curb the increasing amount of egregious behavior that occurs on the field, a red-yellow card system has been implemented as a new tool for the referees.
When a team exhibits over-the-line behavior, as the Wendy bot is doing here, the head referee will issue that team an official warning, a yellow card. That yellow card will then carry with them through the remainder of the competition ladder. During each of their future matches, they'll have a yellow flag placed on their robot to remind them, their alliance partners, the audience, and the referees that they are carrying a yellow card. If they receive another yellow card in any future match, it will automatically become a red card, which will disqualify them from that match. The team will continue to carry their yellow card into subsequent matches.
FIRST hopes that all teams play within the spirit of the competition, and that the red card never needs to be used.
Okay, now, so we hope that'll help. Another thing we've tried to explain in the manual this year is that we're delighted that from special manufacturers you can buy some components that really help make the robots better. In the extreme, however, it's very clear that if you could buy a series of $399 parts that you simply bolt together and that is your robot, that would not be in the spirit of FIRST. So please pay attention to the part of the manual that explains where that division is. We had a great year last year, and a lot of the things that were available to you were wonderful. They really helped. But be careful about rule beaters that try to create a group of parts that get barely under cost limits, so you simply bolt them together. So now, let's meet the guys who make all this happen. Please meet the Game Design Committee.
Dr. Aidan Brown. Bill Miller. Tony Norman, Kate Pilot, Jeremy Roberts, and Dean, Dave, and Woody. Ladies and gentlemen, the 2007 FIRST Robotics Competition Game. 3, 2, 1, 0!
So, the game has some very subtle points this year. Let's learn more about it.
Welcome to the 2007 FIRST Robotics Competition and this year's game, Rack and Roll. The game is played by two alliances, a red alliance and a blue alliance, of three teams each. These alliances are located at the end of the field from where they operate their robots. The center of the field is occupied by the scoring structure known as the rack. Three levels of scoring locations, known as spiders, are located within the rack. Each spider hangs from a series of chains that allows it to move freely if it's impacted by a robot or game piece. The game pieces are inflatable plastic pool tubes. There are three types of game pieces. Keepers are placed during the autonomous period. Ringers are placed during the teleoperated period and score points for the alliance. And the black spoiler tubes are used to negate the effects of the ringers. The objective of the game is to place the keepers and the ringers into rows, which can be either horizontal or vertical. The match starts with a 15-second autonomous period. Robots can use onboard sensors to help locate target lights, which will help identify the location of the scoring targets. As the autonomous period ends, robots must drop any keepers still in their possession. The human operators then step forward and take control of the robots. Robots return to their home zones to retrieve ringers from the human players. Or can drive to the far end of the field to retrieve ringers that are waiting in the opponent's home zone. The ringers are then strategically placed on the rack, and the robots attempt to make as many rows as possible. Here we see a red robot placing a ringer, completing a vertical row of three and a horizontal row of two. His alliance partner then places another ringer, extending the row to three. Black spoiler tubes are placed on the rack and used to negate the effects of the ringers. Unlike the other game pieces, spoilers can be moved and be picked up and relocated to cover any other ringers on the rack. As the match draws to a close, robots will race back to their home zone. Bonus points are earned for each of the Alliance robots that are elevated off the floor. 15 points for 4 inches off the floor, and 30 points for 12 inches or more off the floor. The final score is determined by the length and the number of rows created by game pieces, and then added to the bonus points. In this example, blue squeaks out a win over red, 90-84. Good luck, teams.
Hey, Woody, why don't you show us what this Red Alliance has to offer?
Okay, Dean. Red Alliance is looking good. We've got a 120-pound robot that's 4 feet tall. Oops. Looks like there's been some misbehavior. A yellow card and a wounded manipulator. Interesting. Another 120-pound, 4-foot robot. Good vision system. Good actuator. Looking good. Now, the third one's got something new. It's 5 feet tall. Therefore, it has to weigh no more than 110 pounds. Equipped with good vision, good manipulator.
That's great. Hey, Dave, why don't you show us what the Blue Alliance has got to work with?
Well, Dean, the Blue Alliance is looking really good as well. Our first robot here is really pushing the limits of the height. Going to 6 foot tall, but as a result, can only be 100 pounds. In the middle, we've got a 120-pound robot, but only can be 4 feet tall. And here on the end, right in the middle, we've got our 110-pound robot, 5 feet tall, really playing the variations that are available to the teams. All three robots have got manipulator systems. All three robots have got vision capabilities.
That's great. And speaking of vision capabilities, why don't we get our head ref, Aiden Brown, out here. And Aiden, these guys have vision. We can't make it easy for those guys. Woody, come on out here. Let's give this thing a push.
Okay. Looking good. Is everybody ready? 3, 2, 1, go!
Here we go. Rack and roll. 2 minutes, 15 seconds of robot action. 15-second autonomous period. Robots placing the keepers. Remember, the keepers are there to stay. They cannot be de-scored. Blue Alliance putting up three high. Red Alliance, one in the middle, one low. That's the end of autonomous.
So, Woody, what's going on over here?
This year, if you build a lightweight, tall robot, you can easily reach high, but you're probably not going to win a pushing match against a short, heavy machine.
Got it. And Dave, what's going on over there?
We've got our short, heavy robot backing into position, getting ready for the teleoperator period.
What's the ref looking for?
He's looking for keepers that are not completely on the goal.
Drivers take control of their robots.
It's a smart move that keeper's useless to them now.
Station being fed ringers by the human player. Nine ringers begin the match, leaning on the opposite end of the field from each alliance. Here they come. Red Alliance coming in. A blocker robot down for Red Alliance. Patrolling. Red Alliance now scoring on the middle ring.
That red machine there's is the making ringer. The best of it, even place with a broken arm.
She's still aggressive and effective, but with that yellow card, she can't afford to go over the top.
High position.
That robot and human player are smooth. The one piece at a time rule doesn't seem to slow them down.
Their strategy, trying to develop rows horizontally and vertically on the rack. Two ringers per rack, except if there's a keeper. If there's a keeper, it's yours for the match. Here we go. Red Alliance now scoring, filling up the middle row all the way around. The four position left open. Blue Alliance now. It's their turn to score. Popping one high. Ringer being put on. Five high now being placed by the Kate bot. One.
So does that count?
No, Dave. The ringer has to be touching the spider leg in order to count. It can't be hovering up there like that.
Okay.
1 minute to play now. 1 minute to play, 1 minute remaining. Blue Alliance.
Here come the spoilers.
Looks like they have a plan.
The introduction of the spoilers now. Spoilers negating the ringers.
Ouch! The manipulator broke the plane. The refs got to disable that robot.
Here comes the spoiler from the Red Alliance in the five position placed high. Wendy bot trying to block out. Eric quickly moves by. Places a
blue is really going for it.
Can they get back in time?
Now 30 seconds.
Not if that red blocker has anything to say about it.
She's a tiger out there, even with that yellow card.
Trying to get off the floor. The ramp is down.
That robot's up. That's 15 more points for blue. They're way ahead.
4 inches off the floor. We'll get that referee determination at the end of the match. Remember the last 15 seconds.
What's she doing?
Is the end
wow,
game.
What a play. How do they see that?
The tactician was key there.
Seconds. Blue is up. 5 seconds. Matt trying to make it home with 3, 2, 1.
That was a really great game. Now, based on the placement of the game pieces, red had 44 and blue had 22. Blue got an elevated robot, which gave them another 15 points, bringing them up to 37. But that 10-point penalty for red brought them back down to 34. That means blue wins with 37 over red's 34.
Okay, Blair, what's next?
Dean, we're here to get a little team reaction. I'm here with Justine. Justine, what team are you from?
562 from Fitchburg, Massachusetts.
Okay, Justine, what do you think about this year's game?
I think it looks really awesome, and it's a lot different from last year.
A lot different from last year? We go for that. We'll take that. We look forward to seeing your robot in 6 short weeks out there on the field. We have confidence in you. You can do it. Good luck. But now, it's time for that first game show. It's fast. It's informative. The Family Game Show. First Track, the game that points you to the right direction, to the manual, each and every time. Let's meet our contestants. Our first contestant is NASA's own, Dave the Spaceman Lavery. Our next contestant is the guru of first, the professor who puts the GP in gracious professionalism, Woody Flowers. And our final contestant, the man with all the answers, the man who started it all, first founder, Dean Kamen. And now, how about a warm welcome for our fabulous First Track host, Paul Adonis Gudonis.
Okay, contestants, are you ready?
Yes.
Today we have 3 categories in this game where I will give you the answers first, and you need to respond in the form of a question. So the categories today are distance, power, and game pointers. Well, Woody, you won the servo toss, so you get to go first. So please pick a category, and let's get started.
Okay, Paul, I'll take power for 100.
The answer is 4 maximum.
What's the number of speeding tickets that Dave Lavery gets per year?
How many helicopters can I get into my hangar?
Way to go, Dave. Yes, thank you. And you get to choose the next category.
I'll take game pointers for 100.
The answer is, this cannot be spoiled.
Who is Woody?
What is a keeper?
That's right, Dean. Keepers are just that, keepers. Okay, Dean, where do you want to go next?
Well, I'll take distance for 100.
The answer is 10 feet.
What is twice Dean's height?
If Dave had 10 mouths, how many feet did he just insert?
What is the maximum height of structures in the pit area?
Yes, that's correct. Thank you, Woody. So, let's move along, gentlemen. Woody?
I'll take distance for 500, Paul.
The answer is 1/2 inch or 3/8 of an inch.
Wait. Careful, spaceman.
I'll pass.
If you use plywood to build your robot crate, what are the required thicknesses for the plywood?
That's correct, Woody. All right, you get to choose again.
Okay. Let's try game pointers for 500, please.
The answer is that 4 inches high equals 15 bonus points, and 12 inches high equals 30 bonus points.
What is robot levitation?
How do I score bonus points?
That's correct. Robots in their home zone and not touching the field at the end of the match can score bonus points. So, Dave, you're up.
I'll take power for 500.
Only the MK12 volt battery.
What type of battery can I use for my main power source for my robot during this competition?
Way to go, Dean. That's right. Only the MK12 volt battery is allowed. Last year's battery is not. So, Dean, it's your choice for the next question.
I'll take game pointers for 1,000.
It can still be scored.
The last election.
What happens if my game piece deflates?
Well, that's right, Woody. Yes, even if your scoring tube deflates, it still counts. Okay, Woody, just a couple more.
I'll take distance for 1,000.
The answer is plan ahead.
What do you need to do to get your kit of parts through the airport?
How do I fit a 6-foot-tall robot into a 5-foot-10-inch-tall crate?
That's right, yes. Keep the size of your shipping crate in mind when you design your robots. Okay, Dave, last question on the board is power for 1,000. And the answer is no.
Did Dave give up donuts for New Year's?
Can teams use hydrogen fuel cells on their robots this year?
That's right, Dean. Teams cannot use hydrogen at the events. Leave the hydrogen at home, please. Well, I see that we have a tie score, so it's time for our first track, final bonus question. The answer is the rack.
The penalty for anyone not wearing safety glasses in the pit.
Dean, I'm so sorry, but you didn't answer in the form of a question.
What is the penalty for not wearing safety glasses on the field or in the pits? No.
What is positioned immediately after the robots are placed on the field before the autonomous period starts?
Yes, Dave, that's well done, because just to make rack and roll even more interesting, the rack will be rotated ever so slightly before every match. It's going to be an exciting game we've got to look forward to this year. So thank you, Dean, Dave, and Woody, for your valiant efforts.
We'll see you out there.
And Dave, as today's bonus round winner, you will receive, courtesy of NASA, an all-expense-paid round trip to, well, actually, not quite, but you do get to reveal the password for the encrypted PDF file of the manual.
The password for decrypting the manual is going to be displayed on your screen. Have fun with it.
All right, everyone, thank you, and see you out there,
you
and
there.
Have fun.
I think that went really well. What do you guys think?
I think designing the game's a lot of hard work, but now it's the team's problem.
I can't wait to see what they do with this one.
Sure hope they have a couple of these tubes left over for a pool party.
Yeah, Dave, a little?
Hey, don't get too comfortable, you guys. It's time to start next year's game design.
Wonder where we can get any ideas for next year's game.
I can't imagine what we could be doing next year.
Good luck.
We'll see you at the competition.
What's wrong?